We have a really great event for you guys today. We're going to talk about ICG hardening, and it's one of those things, you know, we've done, Udo did a great webinar on installing ICG, a little bit of troubleshooting, things of that nature, but Sebastian's going to come here and just close this ticket and teach you how to secure it. Right, my friend?
That's hopefully what I would try to achieve today, yes, because if not, I have missed the last 2 days of working for nothing. So hopefully we can bring some content.
I think you'll probably achieve that. So if you guys aren't familiar, my presenter for today is Sebastian, and if you're a member in the Agile community, you'll know who he is, because he is the Agile community from the Agile side. He's everywhere and then some. And if you're not an Agile community member, please join. We do a lot of things like this, but there's also so much going on inside Slack that it's just absolutely phenomenal. And every time, not every time, but almost every time someone joins that has been holding off, they'll come back and say, wow, I'm so glad I joined. I can't believe what's going on here. I'm learning so much. I'm even having fun doing it too. So it's a great place to be. Just go to www.igelcommunity.com, click on the join button, and away you go. On that note, Sebastian, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. So let me start. So just a few things to consider for today. I will shut down my cam in a few seconds just after my introduction, because I want to focus more or less only on the presentation and the comments I will issue. So my name is Sebastian Perruza. I'm working for Agile for about 6.5 years now. I'm working in the pre-sales department. I'm now the enterprise team lead of the enterprise pre-sales team, and I'm based nearby Frankfurt in Germany. For today, we created, let's say, the first part of an ICG or Linux hardening webinar series. And my goal for today is quite easy. I would like to show you how to install a Ubuntu server, which is not such difficult, to be honest, but explain you which steps we need to get the ICG, so the Agile Cloud Gateway, installed in a proper way. That means through the Agile remote installer, through the UMS for the first thing, and from the second part, some tips and tricks on how to add a little bit of security on the Linux operating system. My goal for today isn't to make a whole internet security audit with you. We'll just go through a few topics. And that's the reason why we are planning to make a second or maybe a third part of that kind of webinars, because it's such a huge topic that we cannot achieve that in 1 hour, even in 2 hours. And even if I would go through that all topics for 2 hours, we will lose each other, because it can get dry like sand from time to time, and it can be more exciting for the Linux administrator we have in the call, but for some other people it might be absolutely too deep, or maybe someone too easy to understand. So I just try to keep both worlds in the call. That's the reason why we are starting with a few, let's say, easy to teach features I would like to show you. So in the upcoming event, we will go through a real audit. So at that point, thanks to Stefan Mahlmann, a colleague of mine in the German pre-sales team, which sent over to me a report from the Center for Internet Security. And therefore, we have a few recommendations we can implement on a Ubuntu server. So that's an upcoming event. Same stuff for all that part that you saw in the agenda, that we will in that case start manually by issuing a comment, will be in the next event that need to be scheduled for scheduled tasks. So speaking about claim antivirus client or an AK hunter or whatever else, having proactive scans, proactive processes started, and in the second step, and that might be the same event, maybe having also reporting set it up. So getting an email from that server, or maybe having something written back into the UMS by using the IMI. So we have different possibilities there. What I learned from last session is to lower my screen resolution. So going back to a full HD. So I hope that you can read everything on my screen, and on the comment I will type it a little bit slower than I would do usually. to be absolutely honest, I will have some comment that I will just copy and paste because the chance to make a typo during the typing for myself, even if I've done it 2 or 3 times now, but sometimes even if you got people who are looking at your keyboard, I'm typing my password 2 times in the wrong way. So just to be sure, I will keep some of the comments by copy and paste, but most of them I'll type them quite slow, so easy to read, hopefully. Last thing, I had from the last session the comment to revert my terminal color, so having a white background and a black foreground font, that it's more easy to read. I'm liking both, so I'm no issue by changing it, but if you have the feeling that I have missed something, just write us in the short feedback to Dirk or to myself that I will take over for the next session. So some facts, like more or less on every session I have held in the Agile community, I'm mostly starting with some facts. So I'm usually looking at Wikipedia or some other newspaper stuff. What happened on the day where we are trying to show you some things. And in that case, the 8th of September was one of the first time we didn't have to face only bad news like bombs or terrorist attacks or mass death situations. In that case, we just have something more technical related. So there is there was in that case, a satellite which came back from a sample return journey in space. And just because of a design flaw, the whole satellite had to crash in some desert. And that just because they had apparently a simple element which prevented the parachutes to start. So that's the reason why for today, I hope that you will have the ability to secure a little bit your Linux server and hopefully have less attack surface for some people which are trying to take over your server. Disclaimer, obviously, we are speaking today about a lot of things which are related to security, to Linux, but mostly to topics that are not Agile related. So everything that we'll show you today is something that I put it together in my free time, and please don't rely only on what I'm showing you. Please always speak to your security department, to your system department, to your network department to enhance the security even before it reaches your ICG server, if possible. If you've already done that, perfect, then we can take over the next comments and the next things we'll have a look in the next 30 to 40 minutes. But the second thing I want to point out, because it's a community, an Agile community event, all the methods that we are showing today are not supported by Agile. There are comments that you would easily find by Googling around or just searching for some security tutorials. So just in case, please don't call our support to ask them to help you on the ICG hardening stuff. They couldn't, and they don't have to be honest. So just to be clear, if you have questions on what we saw today, please ask in the chat, or if you have the ability to post your questions on the Azure community, feel free to do that. I would be happy to answer if I can. So the goal for today is quite easy. We just want to deliver you a tool set of features that are, let's say, more or less common in the Linux world. Most of them are already in a script, thanks to Ronea for that, putting together an automatic script. So also comment I've written down, I put it together in a script. We'll have a look if all the comments that I added today can be added as soon as possible, but that's just for your information. In a second step, we'll obviously send over to you all the comments that I've issued today as a standard text file, I guess. That's something we'll have to discuss with Doug. So we are focusing now on a specific operating system, on a specific build number, on let's say also on a specific network environment. So everything that you're seeing here can be picked up can be splitted, can be used one by one, but they're not complementary. So you can use more or less every feature that we spoke, that we will speak about, and have them separated. So usually we're speaking about the how. How did that happen? We have a more or less, at least from my opinion, five reasons why a server can be hacked or a server can be attacked, or your security department would see some issues on an audit. What I'm seeing, I might be wrong, like I said, just my personal opinion, my personal experience, it's mostly related to outdated operating systems or and applications installed on that server. That might be in that case some older kernel versions, that might be related to some applications like the Azure Cloud Gateway, which is outdated. Measurement ports opened. Obviously, we can access a Linux server of different ways. One quite usual way is to use SSH to access the server. And it isn't just dangerous to have the SSH port opened. In some specific cases, they have to stay open for forever. But you can mask them a little bit. You can tweak a little bit around, and even if the port has to, the port have to be to stay open, you can reduce a little bit the attack surface, and disabling some specific features, some specific security security configurations. So that's something that is quite usual. We don't speak about that one specifically today, but think about the webmin, so a small web page where you can administrate your servers through a web page. That's also something that is usually installed on port TCP 10,000. It's a good practice to redirect that port to something else, like 50,000 or 20,000. It isn't such obvious for an attacker, even if he could find it out too. So it's nothing that will hide it completely. But hiding ports and hiding some network informations is something we will see in the NOC and on the fail to ban. Weak passwords. It's still happening that at least on the root user, you have usually a password, or at least you have really, 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 really old Linux system. I'm not sure, to be honest, if there was a build where you didn't have to put a password for root. So I won't say too much about that, but you have sometimes users that you created a long time ago that have a weak password, like we are using at IGEL, the password IGEL. And that's one of the passwords I will use today, obviously, but that's something I wouldn't recommend for a productive environment, obviously. So next thing, the server stays forever in a data center, let's say Azure, let's say AWS or on-prem, and the server will never be scanned, never be checked again after the initial install. So that's the reason why there are a few tools that you can install on the server that will scan, like every antivirus you may have in your company, like, I don't know, Symantec Endpoint Protection or McAfee or whatever, for Linux. In that case, I'm mostly focusing today on open source projects, so nothing that is proprietary or related to some additional licenses. Last one, the man in the middle. I'm a biggest fear in that case. We'll not keep that topic covered today, but that's something we might have in the part number two. So ICG and Linux. I will just shut down now my webcam just to have the session on the ICG and Linux presentation. So I prepared some things in my environment. The environment is, in that case, the Ubuntu server 2004 at Yes Air 64 bits without any additional daemons. So just SSH only installed, but that's something I will show you in my slides. And if needed, some audits are claiming that a disk encryption isn't installed. So in my case, I created a Lux encrypted partition that we are also from the, let's say from the partition field, safe on having an encryption installed if the server gets stolen or exported to some external devices. So I tried to make just a short overview about my environment at home. So we have this PC where I'm showing the presentation. So it's a Windows 10 personal PC, nothing really complicated. But in addition, I have here a little piece of hardware where an ASXE from VMware is installed. And on that ASXI, we have a few servers. So for today, we have three components that we will look on. I have an ICG on an Ubuntu, that's the server where we will work on. I have a UMS Windows virtual machine, which I will access through NDP. That's where I will start the UMS console and the remote installer. And on the last one, I have a UMS on Ubuntu virtual machine that we will access through the VMware console. I just forgot to mention that on the ICG Ubuntu VM, so on the top, we will have two kinds of access, one of the VMware console, so the VMware workstation, and in a second step, after having enabled the SSH connection, a PuTTY connection to that. So I just want to go through quite fast to the installation process. That's the reason why I didn't start the installation itself, because it can take some time. So if you download the ISO file from Ubuntu, pack it into your hypervisor, and boot from the ISO file, you will get that kind of wizard. In that case, I know that the color wasn't inverted. My mistake, I didn't have the chance to reinitiate the screenshot. So I know that the background is still black, but it will change on the console. So we have here the language, we stay on English. The network configuration is quite easy. For your lab, you will stay usually on DHCP. And here we have the encryption part. The encryption part is for the entire disk that you are using. Please keep in mind that if you are using that kind of encryption, if you don't tweak around, you have to enter that passphrase every time the server reboots or boots. So just keep in mind, if you want to use that kind of encryption, you will see that then in my lab, you have to enter your passphrase and then you can log into the server. And just in case, this passphrase cannot, or at least without tweaking a lot around, be entered through SSH or some remote consoles. You have to do that really on the server itself. So using a VMware ASXE console or your VMware workstation. So that's typically something absolutely optional and which I wouldn't recommend to use everywhere. But if you want to use that, just keep in mind that you have to enter that password on every boot. So just to give you a short overview about how I configured the server, nothing really weird or complicated, just a standard Ubuntu installation with my Lux. I choose to give a username like IgilMaster, can be something else, but I just wanted to have something that is clear to read and to understand. And the password in my case is a really complicated one. Please don't use such a simple one for such an important user. In my case, I used IGIL just to avoid some typo from myself. So in that case, please use something complicated with special characters and so on. That's the only daemon I'm installing during the first installation process. I'm just and only installing an open SSH server. You could definitely bypass that installation step in that wizard and going directly to the server installation and installing the open SSH afterwards. No issue at all. But in that case, it made sense to me to make that in one step. So it would just install the open SSH server to give you the ability to connect to the server. Here, just to give an overview, I didn't check anything, so everything is unchecked. So I don't have to disable a lot of services afterwards. I'm just taking the base install. If you are doing that like I did, you should then come to that kind of window. And at the bottom of the list, you see this, please unlock disk dm underscore crypt minus null. That's exactly the moment where you have to enter your passphrase to decrypt the partition. So in that case, I would say we can easily switch now to the lab. Just wanted to, for people like me that were just working on the dark mode, just a short funny handover to my lab. So let me just switch over. So minimizing my PowerPoint and coming back to my VMware work session, which is connected to my ASXi and gives me now the ability to decrypt my partition. So in my case, entering my password. Wait a few seconds. Did I get it? Yeah. So it's booting up, starting other daemons like network daemon and so on. And as soon as the system is started, I will log in with my Angel master user, my high security password. And now we can change what I promised. In that case, we'll change the terminal foreground color to black. So that means the font and the background to white. Just in case, I'm adding an, I don't know how to say it in English, to be honest, this and symbol, which means you execute a second command just after the first one, if it was successful. So hopefully we have now what we wanted to see. So white background and a black font. So now, first thing, I'm pretty sure that I have internet connectivity on my side and on my lab. But just to be sure, I want to check, oops. Yeah, that makes sense, definitely. Ping ubuntu.com makes it, let's say a bit more concrete. Yeah, here we go. So we have a name resolution and we have a connectivity. So that's exactly what I want to see. Next step is to update the whole server because I already did it. Because I did wanted to save some time and didn't want to redownload everything. But usually you will start to make an update. That will fail for a simple reason. We don't have enough permissions. And that's the reason why we are using the command called sudo, which gives you, let's say, a root contact for specific commands. In that case, we will reinitiate the get update that will update all the repositories in our operating system. In that case, you have to enter again the password for your user and check if everything is going fine. Yes, it was. So now I can just add a few comments because the update step doesn't mean that your whole server will be updated on your sources. So if you want to have now a real upgrade process that will be update get dist upgrade minus y just to avoid some prompts if you are sure to apply these updates and add the apt minus get auto remove to remove older packages that are not have to be retained. So like I said, I already updated everything to the last version. So let me check. We have a, let's say, actual kernel version. We are good. But usually you would now have the ability to update your kernel, to update the OpenSSH server, which was installed during the first installation process. And just in case, I would add a short note. If you had a kernel update, I would suggest to restart the server after the update because then the new build image would be used. So now we have all the latest updates and we should be good. One of the issues we are seeing on ICG install. If you get some certificate errors on the endpoint during the registration process, it's mostly related to missing time synchronization. So I would highly suggest to install an NTP, so a net time protocol client. So we don't need a daemon because we could obviously create a service just to propagate the time service into your network, but usually you have your own one. So we just want to have the client. So wait a few seconds to have all the components installed. That one is a quite easy one. And just to double check, I will go again through the sudo command and then issuing the vi editor, which enables me to edit files and change them, save them as I would do in a notepad or edit command in Windows. So I know that it should be located in etcntp.conf. Just double check that it fits in my region and that gets the standard Ubuntu pool. That looks good. Now we could make a query. So it was minus P for print. Yeah. So we can now see if we have a delay, if we're missing something, but that looks pretty good. So the next step is, since we're not wanting to have only a Linux server up and running, but we want to use an Agile component on that server called the ICG, we will create a new user. So this user will then be used for the ICG remote installer that we're using from ZOMS. I'm usually transferring the binary to the server by using SCP or whatever and issuing the installation log in the command line interface from the server itself. But just make it simpler, you can use the remote installer and remote updater from the UMS. So I'm adding the new user. In that case, I'm staying with my specific password. And here we can just bypass everything. And yes, the informations were correct. So now we are adding that user. If you remember the documentation from iAgile regarding the remote ICG installer to the sudo group. So that's the command we're issuing now. So we are, after creating the user, we are putting him into the sudo group, that this user is able to use a root context for some specific commands. Okay, went through. So now we are checking just to be sure that everything was done like expected. And that obviously would help you to check if the user you are using for the UMS remote installer is in sudo group. So sudo minus L minus uppercase U ICG install will give you feedback on the screen. And use ICG install may run the following commands on ICG all. So we are good. Next thing, since we created a user, we could now check the SSH connectivity because I don't want to stay in the VMware console because of the resolution, because of some copy and paste function. So I want to connect to the server using SSH. In that case, like promised, we will check if the configuration is there for the SSH server, so the daemon. It is, so it's the SSH daemon minus config file. And there, I hope that you can read something here. I will change the standard port, which is usually used by SSH, which is the port TCP22, to something absolutely different, like 60,022. That would help if someone will start a port scan to your server and see if the port 22 is opened. He would know that he could try to connect to your server by using the SSH, using brute force or wordless attacks or whatever. So changing it to something else might decrease a little bit the risk to be recognized as an SSH service. So the next thing is permit root login. The simple answer to root login is no. We don't want to have a root login in any kind of access. So no one should be able to connect by opening a PuTTY or SSH connection by using the user root. Next topic, empty passwords. It might be empty. Here we go. We want to disable any kind of empty password for SSH, which makes sense because if you have a user like, I don't know, ICG installed, you made one time and forget to set a password, and this user is able to connect to the SSH daemon, it could be a potential risk. Last one, so I'm going at the end of the list, so at the end of the configuration file, I will add two specific configuration parameters, which are called allow users, angel master, which is in that case my user on the Ubuntu side, and a remote IP address. This remote IP address is one of my PCs here, so the Windows PC we are working on at the moment. And we'll add a second one, which is called allow users, ICG install. My mistake. ICG install at my UMS server. So what does that mean in the real world? As soon as we'll apply this setting, only the user agent master coming from the IP address 91 will be able to connect to the SSH daemon. Same stuff, but from the UMS server, which is the 241 IP address, which is my Windows UMS server, I will give you an access from there, but nothing else. So now it's time to restart the daemon, so the service. Okay, service was restarted. Let me check if the status, so if the service was started, if some errors were shown, or if the config files would be missing, or if one of the configuration I made into my SSH underscore config file was broken. That looks pretty good, I would say. Most important information in that specific case is that the server is listening on port 60022. So now we shouldn't be able to connect by using the standard port 22, but my corrected one. Okay, if everything is working, we should now be able to connect to my ICG by using this port. So keep your finger crossed, please. Obviously, it's not such a surprise that it worked, but I'm happy. So having here the user agent master connecting by SSH. So we are here again changing our font and background color to something more readable. And now we are focusing on the firewall. So we are using the UFW, which is, I guess, part of most of the Ubuntu-based distributions, which is by default installed on that command. So UFW. Is already in the newest version installed. So perfect. Doesn't have to install anything else. So we should then check if the firewall is already started. Yes, it is. That's great. So now, since we are knowing that everything is started and everything is installed, we should add some some routes to that firewall. So usually I would say from the server itself, everything that is outgoing should be allowed. I might be wrong, but in most of my customer situation, that's what the customer is wanting. So incoming ports should be controlled, but outgoing ports doesn't. So UFW default allow outgoing. Yep, that's good. It's changed to allow. So now we need some other rules. In that specific case, we need a rule for the port 8443, which is a port we are using in a standard way for the UMS server to ICG communication or from an endpoint outside of the company network on the perimeter network to the ICG. So we are using 8443, but if you specified something else in your data sheet, you could use the port you're needing. So use allow 8443/TCP. Here we go. Same for, just to be sure, even if we could change that in a further step, I would use the 6022 TCP, which is our SSH port. So now we should only have two ports and the outgoing communication, which is enabled. Let me enable the firewall. So now everything is controlled by the firewall itself. And now we can check the status itself. Let me just check back here we go. So we have 8443, 60022 for V4 and for V6. Perfect. Looks good. Since we have now the network communication, the SSH connection, the firewall set it up, we could now go to one of the CIS recommendation. It's to avoid a memory shared attack against your tempfs folder, which is usually a shared folder. That's a little bit complicated, maybe. And I have to be absolutely honest, I didn't create the command itself that you are seeing here. I'm mostly relying on what we saw in the report we received. So it's just avoiding that someone can take over your temporary folder, which is stored usually in the RAM. So you cannot escape off of your server. So as soon as you enter that one into your fstep file, usually you could issue a command to remount that folder. But since we already have a pending reboot because of the kernel update, I would suggest to reboot the server afterwards. So I would just confirm that I want to write and quit. So saving that file, I forgot to mention that before. So sorry if I didn't went through the VI comments, but WQ just means write and quit. So we are saving the file and quitting the file. Next thing, every user has, let's say, a specific ID and in a specific context, the root has the highest UID possible, and this highest UID possible is the number null. Usually, and if you don't have to bypass that the feature, I would highly suggest to have only the root user using that upper ID and avoid that anything that anyone else, sorry, is able to be UID null. So we have there double check that there is only one root user with the highest UID. So we are fine. If you get more than one, there might be a reason, even if it isn't recommended, but in some specific case, it might be. So if you have more than that, please ask your system administrator if there was a reason If not, I would investigate a little bit and try to remove that user if it's not needed. Okay. Next thing that I promised is to check if we have user with empty passwords. For that behavior, we have a comment which looks like this, which shows the content of the file etc shadow, which lists more or less every user that is in your system, and checks if there is an empty password by using this awk command and see if something is just empty. That's what you see after the equal. We have nothing, but we should, just to be sure, double check if the comment is working. So I will add a new user called empty. So nothing really special, but I would then add the reset password to empty for that user. And now this user doesn't have a valid password. So let me reissue the comment we just started before. Yes, now we have an answer. So we have a user with an empty password, which is called empty. What you could do now is quite easy, sudo passwd to user empty and give him a new password. And now we could reissue that command and double check that nothing else reappeared. Now we are coming to some proactive features. Like I said in the beginning, this kind of comments are quite sure and doesn't interfere with your connectivity. Everything that we will see now, like fail to ban and knocking, might definitely close every connection to the server. So please be extremely careful on that one and be sure that you have a control access to the server if something went wrong. If you don't want to use that one, it isn't mandatory at all. It's just, like I said, a tool set we will try to deliver to you. So we are using a tool called fail to ban. So let's imagine someone is trying to access your server and will port scan the server. After the port scan, he will see that there is a port called 60022, which is opened. And he will try to log in. And he will try to log in 10 times, 100 times, 1,000 times, how often he can. What you could do there, just to be sure that even if he tries this one or two times, after the third time, this IP address would be banned, so cannot access your server in any way in anymore. That's the role of the fail to ban stuff. So we install it, by using a pre-install package. So just follow everything which is as a dependency. And now we have to create a config file for that daemon. So fail to ban and jail.local. So I prepared a configuration for today, which makes exactly what we spoke about. So we'll just copy that one, to be absolutely honest, and put that into the configuration window. So enable true is quite easy to understand. We just want to be sure that this proactive tool is enabled. We'll check on the port 60022 a specific filter, which is a file which is delivered by the fail to ban daemon by itself. Then check the log file that the SSH daemon is writing into. So if, let's say, I'm trying to access a server, I'm not allowed to, every try for myself to enter a password will be logged into this authentication.log file and would show a deny error. Max we try is how many times a person can enter a wrong password before being banned. Oops, sorry, my mistake. So write and quit. Now let's check if the fail to ban daemon is already started. active running. Yes, it is. So we have to restart it. Here we go. And we have to restart it. Okay, so now Fail2Ban should be started. We could now check if the Fail2Ban client is doing what he should. Yes, so status for the jail SSH daemon. Currently failed nothing. That's good. Obviously, no one is in my own network and tries to access the server. So that looks pretty good. But we should now try to simulate what would happen. So let me open an SSH connection from one of my IGL devices and check if, so SSH minus P is in that case a port we want to use, and the IP address of the server, of the ITG server. So here we go, 98. Yes, password, even if the root user isn't allowed. I will just try to enter a few times the password. Okay, permission denied. Let me check again. Oh, yes, currently failed, one. Total failed issue tried four times. And this IP address is now banned. So I can try to restart this this SSH connection, and connection refused. So I'm not able to connect to that SSH server from that IP address anymore. That's the reason why I'm saying, if you want to use that kind of daemons, just be extremely careful, please. So just to be clear, you can obviously just unban that IP address. So set SSHD, unban IP. And that should be this one, hopefully. Yep, let me check again the jail, and we see banned list is now empty. So let me restart. Yes, we are now able to enter a password. So we just keep that one, but that means that your server is more or less, in that case, more or less secured against some brute force attacks through SSH. So that's Fail2Ban. It's not just a short note on that one. It's not only related to SSH. You can do a lot more by using Fail2Ban. You can protect your POSFIX mail relay or your web servers. If someone tries to access some folders that aren't available for the World Wide Web, et cetera, et cetera. It's quite complex. It can get even complexer, but it's one of the tools I'm using, at least for my own servers. Next tool I would like to show you is the AirKey Hunter, so Rootkit Hunter. It's not exactly an antivirus solution because it does way more. So we have to install it first. So AirKey Hunter. We have a little bit more dependencies than on the other packages, so we just go everything and say okay. The reason why you have a lot of dependencies, this tool can deliver automatic emails. You can define some action if something went wrong. Like I said, that would be part of an upcoming session. But like I said, that's the reason why it's having a little bit more dependencies. Like here for the POSFIX or for the mail relay, we don't have something like that set it up in that specific server case. So we just skip all that configuration by default and bypass that. So the daemon would be installed just after that. And what happens with that tool? This tool checks, obviously, if some, let's say, non-rootkits are on the server. But it, like I said, it does a little bit more. Let's imagine someone breaks in your server, breaks in, and add a new user. that's something you would see in the Air Care Hunter too. So let's imagine I'm trying to add a new user like MT2 or MT1. I did just before with the empty password. That's something we'll see here. But let me just firstly show you how it looks like when you have hopefully no issues or just a few. So we'll start a check of Air Care Hunter. Okay, here we go. So he's checking some environment, is checking checksum of some binaries we have in user bin. And just to get you onboarded, if something would change there, it can be an update of the operating system, but it can be something malicious, you would be notified. So replacing systemctl, like an example binary, by something malicious would be listed here. So now checking the rootkits, hopefully you will not find anything. I'm pretty sure that he wouldn't. Looks good for the moment. Yeah. Next thing, checking some additional rootkit feature sets. So to be absolutely, I'm not aware of every check rootkit is delivering, but I'm usually using everything. But now I'm pretty sure that we are getting on the network. Yeah, right. On the network and the local file system. So checking for hidden files and directory, like an example, if someone would copy stuff on your server without your agreement, that would be listed here. But like we saw, nothing really red or yellow was shown. So that was good. Let's imagine we add a new user called MT2. Oops, yeah, that makes sense. Okay, and like before, we'll just leave it like this. I will now start the check again, but not the whole check because it takes some time and we don't have so much time left. So we'll just use a specific part of the check. In that case, what we already saw just before, the local host check, where the Air Care Hunter will check now the, let's say the user database and user files. And now we see that we have a warning. The warning states that there was a passvd file change and a group file change that is related to my added user. So that would typically give you an alert if someone tries to access your server and tries to take over the configuration. Okay, we have about 5 minutes left. So I would like to show the last two topics, the pod knocking and ClamAV. I would say that we start with a ClamAV, which is a clam like a shell. Antivirus solution, and that one is, I made a mistake with my foreground colors, to be honest. So we have to install first the ClamAV daemon and the client. So ClamAV and ClamAV minus daemon, hopefully, yep, should work like expected, and reinstalling that one. So the first thing to do after the installation itself is to, it depends a little bit from the version of ClamAV, but that's what I'm doing usually, is to stop the daemon, so the service that is using the antivirus. Stop ClamAV, fresh clam, which is the, my mistake, is a daemon which regularly refresh the virus definition. And now we will just issue the fresh clam command, which should update the definition file quite fast and just load the last version of the database, so of the virus database that is available. And as soon as the file was downloaded and applied, we will start the daemon again and check if we have a virus or a listed file in a specific folder. So just show you how to start a manual scan. Okay, so let's start again the daemon. So now we have a, let's say, a kind of antivirus, which is in the last state. And now we can use the clam scan command again, against a folder called /varlog. And now just let the clam scan component check everything in that folder against this database we just downloaded before. Like I said, hopefully you will not find anything there. I'm pretty sure that not, but it takes some time. So here we go. Nothing found, no infected file 0. So that one, that part of the window is important. Great. Like I said, all the scheduled tasks will be done in a further session. Now we have the pod knocking feature. It's after the fail to ban, one of the of my favorite tools I'm using on my server. But there again, be extremely careful because the pod knocking is a mechanism that that reacts to network port opening and closing features. So let's imagine you want to access your server and you want to disable SSH access if you're not on the server anymore. That's usually something you would do in a firewall rule. But how to regain connect to that server? You would have to have a kind of service which reacts to something that you sent to him. And that's exactly what the pod knocking is doing. If I would like to access SSH, I would like to open a pod, then a second one, then a third one in a specific order and in a specific time frame to give my server the information, hey, dear server, please now open the port for the SSH and give me an access to my SSH daemon. That's exactly what the pod knocking daemon is doing. So like every time today, we do an apt-get install, and we are searching for the package knockd, so knock daemon. It's installed, it's a really small one. And now we have to open the configuration file, which is located in knockd.conf in /etc. And here we have the standard open SSH and close SSH sequence. So in the standard configuration that you see here, if you make an NC or telnet or whatever port comment to the server and say, hey, port 7000, are you open? No, that's fine. Then doing the same stuff for 8000 and then after that to 9000, it would open an IP tables rule. In that case, we don't have an IP tables, but the UFW, so the smaller firewall. So that's the reason why I'm deleting that configuration in that case and just adding my own one that I created for today, which is more or less the same like you saw just before, but with different ports and with different UFW commands. So what happens if I would open port 8888, then 7777, it will add a firewall rule that allows my personal IP address where I started the network communication from to access the SSH server and my UMS server for the remote installer. And if I would go to 55555, then 66666, it would delete all that rules and will close the port that we're using for the SSH. So let me save that file. I know that we're a little bit over time, so I hope that you can still follow me a bit. I would try to go fast. I have to edit another file, which is called default knockd, just to enable the knock daemon itself. So I change the one and You have here the option to change the network adapter where the daemon is should listen to. In that case, it's my ENS32, so it's my network adapter, which is listed here. So we should not be good on that one. So just the need for having the daemon again restarted, restart knock D. That's true, knock D. And again, after starting or restarting the daemon, I'm checking the state of the knock D daemon. Starting up, listening on my network adapter. That looks good. Now let's switch to my UMS server on Linux. And check if I'm going through that port order. Yes. Here we go. SSH running command, opening the port 60,022 for the IP address 1250, which is my Linux server. Here we go. Well, let's say workstation in that case. And for my UMS, so 241. So hopefully now, if I'm issuing a sudo UFW status, I'm seeing exactly what I told you. I'm just reverting. So we saw exactly that the two rules were added. Looks pretty good. So now we are doing exactly the opposite way. So we are closing a ZSH port remotely by knocking on port 5555 and 6666. Again. Close SSH, running command, delete from. So I removed my SSH connection for these two servers. Obviously, what I would suggest then, if you're looking at your firewall, I would then disable that rule that I created before for the port 60,022, because now we still have an access. But that's what I said, it's just a second fornet, just to be sure that everything works. Last one. Before going to the remote installer, just to check that everything is working now, I promised you to having a comment to check unneeded services on your server. So issuing systemctl list unit files grep enable will show you every service that is started by boot up on your Linux server. So that's, I would say, part of a second session to check which services now could be disabled to leverage a little bit the attack surface. So I would just keep the last step, switching to my UMS, going into my UMS administration, using my remote installer. So I prepared for my local ICG test environment, a safe sign certificate in my UMS, and now we are trying to install a new Azure Cloud Gateway. So using that one, right? Yes, here we go. I accept the license and everything which is in it and double check that the port is not using 22 anymore. The SSH user is ICG install. The password is high security one. And for the rest, let me double check that I'm using the right binary. And please keep your finger crossed that not the last step will fail, because to be honest, I didn't retry it since 2 days. So running for 15 seconds now. Still quite normal until now. But it shouldn't take ages, to be honest. Yes, there. So we are done. The ICG was installed remotely by using a sudo, and we could now remove our firewall rule for the 60,022. So thank you very much for your attention and patience and for the 7 minutes over time. Doug, if you want, you can for the questions, if there was some.
You got it. First of all, I'll take the blame. Sebastian and I had a little bit of a confusion, and he had this thing scheduled for an hour and a half, and I had it scheduled for an hour. So it's my fault that he sort of ran out of time. The guy has more to share with you than I gave him time for. So my apologies. That being said, I absolutely loved it. I hope you guys did too. So please, if you have any questions, we'll stick around and answer questions. Of course, we are recording this. So if you need to drop, you can watch this. I'll get this thing posted in the IGL community announcements channel tomorrow about midday. Also, if you have any suggestions about future events that you would like, Sebastian hasn't mentioned a part two, but if there's any other type of topics you would like, please let us know. If you don't think of them right now, shoot us an email or best post them in the community somewhere. Chit chat is probably the best place. That being said, let's get to some questions. Will the slides be shared after the webinar? Yes, we'll share those tomorrow. Correct, Sebastian?
Exactly.
The slides too? Perfect. Yeah. So he'll send those to me. And when we share the recorded version, we'll also put the slides up there so you can download those. Just to be sure, the Nano Editor can be used as well, correct?
Yes, definitely.
Perfect. How can you disable TLS 1.1 on an ICG server? 8443.
If you wouldn't mind, I would put that in the part two session.
I won't mind at all. That's a good question.
But I promise.
Yeah. Now the next question is, when is part two? We'll
in
get
the
to
future.
That information. In the future. Very good one. I like that answer. Good old David. Is the fail to ban retries consecutive over a specific period of time or for lifetime?
It's a question of configuration. You can specify just a specific amount of time or an amount of retries. It's just a question of configuration, but you can configure exactly what you want. So having just a retry in a few minutes, so having a period of 3 minutes, if you are trying to type in your password 3 times in this 3 minutes, you will be banned. Or say, okay, you can do that forever, which is not recommended, but can be easily achieved.
Perfect. Will the nmap scan trigger the NOCD?
Yes.
Is that what that is, NOCD?
Yes, yes, it will. And that's the reason why I'm usually using ports that are not following each other. And for opening the ports, I'm usually doing the opposite way. So I'm using first the higher number, so 8888, and the second is then 777, because it's not every time the same, but on most port scanners, I know that's not every time the case, but it's going from port 1 to port 50,000, but it's counting up. It's not counting down. So that's the reason why I'm using ports that are not following each other. So 8 to 7, and not from 7 to 8, but from 8 to 7 for opening. So yes, it's a short answer.
Perfect. And Kev writes, will there be recording? Yeah, definitely, bud. Jonathan, tuning TLS 1.2 on Apache would be a good idea. And then he gives a nice little link there too for the future.
Definitely.
And in the chat, David Prowse says, session two starts now. Go!
Okay. have to prepare a few things. my connection is getting quite poor. No, but yeah, I'm absolutely with you. We have a few topics to cover, and Jonathan, you're right. It's definitely one thing, but at the moment we focus on the Linux side, and everything that is related to the ICG itself, that might be a little bit misleading from my title, will be part of the second one. But we'll definitely take care about that one too.
You bet.
And what we would do maybe on the next step, I didn't try it to be absolutely honest, but I would do that for the next step. I would try to check if the fail to ban can be combined with a filter that is failed connection to the ICG service itself. That might be also an idea, but let's check that one in the next session.
You bet. And guys, there's a bunch in the chat that I can't see it. I need my glasses. But if we missed anything, please let us know. You have a couple more minutes to ask a few more questions, then we'll call this a night. or morning, depending on where you are. Are there plans for ICG on Windows platform?
No, the short answer is the short answer and the fast answer is no. And I have to be absolutely honest, I'm pretty sure that we don't even think about that at the moment. I know that the question was already asked in the community too. If you think that there is really a huge demand for that in your country, in your market, in your customer role, please write that into the feedback section of the Agile community. And if you have the ability to add a thumb up, so a plus one, if you think that you need that for your company, please add it and we will definitely look about it. But for the moment, I'm pretty sure that we don't have that on the roadmap.
Yeah. Makes sense. Guys, I think that's all the questions. So Sebastian, as always, amazing job. I mean, I sat here, I don't understand all this stuff. I'm a community guy nowadays. I know you guys are much smarter than me, but I really enjoyed it. I think everyone did too. And we look forward to part two. We look forward to doing more of these. So again, guys, if you know there's a part two coming, but if there's other topics you really like to dive into, let us know. Also, just to give you a little sneak peek, Sebastian and I started down the path of planning a one-day conference. We want to do like a really deep dive conference thing. So I'm at the early stages of planning. So if there's any type of sessions you would like in something like that, please let us know. My idea was to do a full build, deep, you know, the whole nine yards, but I don't know if that's a good idea. So let us know. Go to Agile Community and just sort of chat about this stuff. Tell us what you want. At the end of the day, the community is about you. So what we do is what we feel that you would like, but if we don't know, we don't know. So please let us know. I think that's it, guys. Smash on any last words?
Thank you very much, guys.
Yeah, thanks, everybody. Have a great day. And as we say in Germany,
tschüss.
Tschüss. I love that part.